Op amps are great little devices. They provide high gain, low distortion, and they're really the analog designer's dream. But can you get gains of 100 or more at bandwidths of 25 kHz plus from a single amplifier stage? The answer is no, but we're going to look at why you can't and how to get round the problem by knowing how much gain you can get from a single amplifier stage. We're going to tell you all you need to know about op-amp frequency response, why the frequency response is so limited, how this affects circuit design, and we'll also cover the important topic of gain bandwidth product, and at the end, you'll have a good understanding about it all. Op-amps are widely used in analog electronic circuits. They provide an exceedingly high level of open-loop gain, in addition to their very high input impedance and low output impedance. The gain in chip datasheets is normally expressed in terms of volts per millivolt, where 1 volt per millivolt is equal to a gain of 1,000. And for example, a gain of 100 volts per millivolt is equal to a voltage gain of 100,000. It's done this way because it's easier to express it like this. Although they have an enormous gain, op-amps are not normally used in an open-loop configuration. To use their colossal gain effectively, negative feedback is normally placed around the amplifier as we see here. This is a typical inverting amplifier circuit, although non-inverting amplifiers are just as widely used. To understand a little more about the frequency response of these amplifiers, we need to look at the very earliest op-amps. Circuits using these chips were prone to bursting into oscillation, and therefore later chips like this 709 had external components added to keep the circuit stable. The simple circuit for the inverting amplifier we're used to seeing today required some additional components if it was to operate correctly with these early chips. This external compensation, as it was called, needed 3 or 4 additional components, as we see here. Later chips incorporated compensation into the chip itself. The first op-amp IC to do this was the 741, which is still in widespread use today. A small capacitor was added into the IC itself to provide this compensation. Introducing compensation into the chip reduces its bandwidth, but makes it stable. In fact, the band over which it exhibits its highest open-loop gain before it falls away is relatively small. As the frequency increases, the gain soon starts to fall away. Typically, for most chips, the breakpoint, or the point where the gain has fallen by 3 dBs, is only a few hertz. The gain falls at a rate of 6 dBs per octave. In other words, it falls away by 6 dBs for every doubling in frequency. This equates to 20 dBs per decade, or a reduction in gain by 20 dBs for a frequency increase by a factor of 10. But all is not lost. We can use negative feedback. Placing negative feedback around the amplifier means that the gain of the overall amplifier is less, but remains flat over a much wider bandwidth, and this is usually what we want. In fact, we can have more gain and less bandwidth, or more bandwidth and less gain. We can express this fact as a simple equation. There is a figure called the gain bandwidth product. This is a constant for the chip. As the name implies, the gain bandwidth product is equal to the voltage gain AV for the overall circuit times F, which is the bandwidth or the highest frequency before the response falls away. Let's take the example of a common op-amp chip. The 358 seen here is low cost and it's easy to obtain. It has a gain bandwidth product of 0.7 MHz, so we can drop this into the equation. If we want a gain of, let's say, 100, this means that in the equation, AV is equal to 100. We also know from the datasheet that the gain bandwidth product is 0.7 MHz, and so by rearranging the equation, we can see that the bandwidth we can get for a gain of 100 is only 7 kHz. This may not be enough for many situations. Hi-fi audio amplifiers normally need 20 kHz or more. So if we want a bandwidth of 20 kHz, let's call it 21 kHz to make the calculations a little easier. By entering the figures into the equation and doing a little manipulation, we can see that the maximum gain we can get is only 33.3. In reality, the figure for the unity gain bandwidth from the datasheet is only a typical figure. No minimum figure is specified. It may vary, so we need to include a significant margin in our calculations. So the maximum gain we can obtain to ensure our bandwidth may only be as much as 20. So this shows the importance of using the figures for the gain bandwidth product in a design. Before working out the values for the components in the circuit, we need to work out the maximum gain we can safely achieve for the bandwidth we want. Now you can go on to design your amplifier.